Hello everybody and welcome to our Sunday service, and especially warm welcome if this is your first time with us. It's lovely to have you worshipping with us online today. Coming up today, after our notices, Roger Gillard is going to be leading us in prayer. We have a guest speaker who's going to be talking to us all about Jesus' disciples on the Emmaus Road. And then linking it all together, we've also got a great selection of Easter hymns for you to sing along to. And I hope that as we worship together today, we'll all have an encounter with the Lord and know afresh the joy of his presence in our lives. But before we come to that, let's take a look at our notices. First of all, if you'd like some information about services this weekend and over the coming weeks and everything else that's going on in our parishes, then do please check our online newsletter, which you can subscribe to through our website, hopechurchfamily.org, or else also visit our website calendar page, hopechurchfamily.org/calendar, where you can find everything that's going on. Second thing to mention, I'd like to point you in the direction of our online collection. It's great that so many of you do give online. We really, really appreciate the way you bless our work. If you don't give or you'd like to give more to help us with the cost of our work in the community and maintaining our buildings, then do please visit our online giving page for more information. Thank you. Shall we be quiet then for a moment? And we'll begin. O Lord, open our lips, and our mouth shall proclaim your praise. In your resurrection, O Christ, let heaven and earth rejoice. Alleluia! And let's celebrate Jesus' victory over death by singing How Great Thou Art.
Thy hand hath made. I see the stars, I hear the mighty thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the word and feel the gentle wind.
He made it all.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, I'm not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my
sin. Thank you, Lord.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God. My Savior God, to thee.
We've just sung of how on the cross Jesus, my burden gladly bearing, bled and died to take away my sin. That's the great hope that Easter holds out to us, that sin and death have been defeated. And so trusting in that promise of God, let's take a moment to reflect upon our week, and then we'll turn back to the Lord in prayer. Would you pray with me? Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore us to the joy of your salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And may Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our psalm this morning is part of Psalm 136, a great celebration of God's mercy. I'll say the odd-numbered verses. Why don't you respond with the even? Give thanks to the Lord, for he is gracious, for his mercy endures forever. Give thanks to the God of gods, for his mercy endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord of lords, for his mercy endures forever. Who alone does great wonders? For his mercy endures forever. Who by wisdom made the heavens? For his mercy endures forever. Who laid out the earth upon the waters? For his mercy endures forever. Who made the great lights? For his mercy endures forever. The sun to rule the day? For his mercy endures forever. The moon and the stars to govern the night? For his mercy endures forever. Who smote the firstborn of Egypt, for his mercy endures forever, and brought out Israel from among them, for his mercy endures forever, with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, for his mercy endures forever, who divided the Red Sea in two, for his mercy endures forever, and made Israel to pass through the midst of it, for his mercy endures forever. But Pharaoh and his host he overthrew in the Red Sea, for his mercy endures forever, who led his people through the wilderness, for his mercy endures forever. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. Let's pray. Remember us, O God, and shape our history. Form our inward eyes to see the shadow of the life-giving cross in the turbulence of our time, for his sake who died for all, Christ our Lord. Amen. Well, our first Bible reading today is taken from the book of Acts, chapter 5, beginning at the 27th verse. The apostles were brought in and made to appear before the Sanhedrin to be questioned by the high priest. "We gave you strict orders not to teach in this name," he said. "Yet you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching and are determined to make us guilty of this man's blood." Peter and the other apostles replied, "We must obey God rather than human beings. The God of our ancestors raised Jesus from the dead, whom you killed by hanging him on a cross. God exalted him to his own right hand as Prince and Saviour, that he might bring Israel to repentance and forgive their sins. We are witnesses of these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our reading there spoke of the power of the cross to defeat evil and death. Why don't we pick up that theme now as we sing our second hymn, "Oh, to see the dawn of the darkest day." And why don't you stand for this one if you feel able.
To see the dawn of the darkest day, Christ on the road to Calvary, tried by sinful men, torn and beaten then, nailed to a cross of wood and oak.
do please take a seat. We're going to have our second reading now, which is taken from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, beginning at verse 13. Now that same day, two of Jesus' followers were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what's more, it's the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see Jesus." He said to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?" And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he exclaimed to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going further. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it's nearly evening. The day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread and gave thanks, broke it and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, "It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. While they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you troubled, and why do doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and feet, and while they still did not believe it because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. He said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Then he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. He told them, "This is what is written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I'm going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And now here's my old friend, Pastor Mark Duggan, who's our guest preacher today, to share with us some thoughts about the disciples on the Emmaus Road.
Let me pray, and then we'll start. Father God, we thank you for this Easter day. We've had many Easters, eaten lots of chocolate, and yet sometimes the meaning of Easter has either dulled, or we've glanced over it, or we've not taken it in at all. So, Lord, I pray today that you will remind us or teach us what Easter means, what it's really all about. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let me start with a story. This is a guy a guy called Gail Halverson. You may have read his obituary recently. He died last month, aged 101. And he was a cargo pilot, and he was nicknamed Uncle Wiggly Wings. Anybody got the same nickname? Uncle Wiggly Wings. After the Second World War, when Berlin was divided between East and West, in I think it was 48, Berlin was blockaded, West Berlin was blockaded by the Soviets, so pilots had to fly overhead dropping food parcels, cargo supplies, so that the West German people stranded in Berlin wouldn't starve. Now, Gail had lost friends during the Second World War, so he wasn't happy about helping Germans. But his attitude changed one day when he came across a boundary fence, and there was a bunch of German children standing behind that perimeter fence, and he went up to them and he pushed some chewing gum through the chain link fence. And he noticed that the kids who got the gum then tore up the wrappers and gave little pieces to all their friends. And those friends would start sniffing the smell of the sweet treat. And it was at that moment that Gail's attitude towards Germans changed, and he promised that he would fly over the next day and drop a load of sweets. "But how will we know it's your plane?" the children asked. And he said he would wiggle the plane wings. And so that's what he did. He dropped his food supplies, but he also dropped sweets in parachutes made of handkerchiefs. Soon, news of the candy bomber, he's an American, was reported in the papers, and Halverson was summoned to see his commanding officer. And he thought he was going to be court-martialed. Instead, he was congratulated for helping to fix post-war relations between America and Germany. And after that, donations of sweets and chocolates came pouring in. And they reckon that 23 tons of sweets were eventually dropped using 250,000 handkerchiefs. Of course, Gail dropped plenty of food too, but it was the sweets he was remembered for. A simple act of friendship which mended fences and built friendship between two previously warring peoples. Now that is a small taster of what Easter is all about. You see, Easter is not a revenge movie. It's quite the reverse. Think about it. The 11 disciples, they've let Jesus down. The Gospel of John tells us they were in hiding. They were frightened that they might be arrested by the Jews. They'd arrested Jesus and killed him, so surely they were going to be next. So they were hiding, they were scared. They no doubt felt guilty about that. Peter especially felt guilty. He denied knowing Jesus. "Do you know Jesus?" "No, I never met the guy." 3 years he'd been with him. And a young servant girl says, "Oh, I think I saw you with Jesus." And, "Oh, no, never met him." Now here, Jesus is in the room with them. Jesus must be so disappointed with them. So angry with them. Maybe that's how you'd feel if Jesus appeared right now in this room. If he sat next to you. Jesus knows everything about you. You might feel ashamed. Is Jesus disappointed in you? I'm sure Peter felt that as he saw Jesus in the room, wondering, is he going to get a dressing down? Is he going to be blanked? What will Jesus say? I love how the first words out of Jesus' mouth are, "Peace be with you." That's what the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus are all about, peace. The Easter story is not a revenge movie. It's all about rescue. Jesus died so enemies of God could become friends of God. In that story, I told you, Gail had a change of heart towards Germans who he'd previously hated. But that's not needed to happen to God. God's always loved us. He's loved us so much, that's why he sent Jesus to come into our world, to go exactly behind enemy lines not standing at the fence, but to go behind enemy lines to rescue us, to reconcile us to God, to bring us back together with him. The Easter story, it's all about God rescuing us. And on that first Easter Sunday, Jesus then opened up the scriptures, the Bible, to those followers. And he explained to them the real meaning of Easter. It was all there if they had but eyes to see. Now, I don't have time to do all of that. But luckily, our friends from M&S have produced an advert to help us with all things Easter. So let's watch this advert from M&S and let's hear about Easter.
This isn't just a lamb. This is the lamb provided by God himself as a sacrifice, the innocent lamb of God.
The lamb who is silent before his persecutors and who takes away the sin of the world. A perfect lamb, chosen before the creation of the world, but revealed now for our sake.
This isn't just a hot cross bun. This is the bread of God, who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world, the bread of life.
And this is the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, the cross that he died on in our place, so that we could be rid of guilt and free to live the right way.
These aren't just Easter lilies. These are bulbs that were buried in the ground, just as Jesus was buried in a stone-cold tomb on the first Good Friday, but now springing back into vibrant life, full of joy and truth.
This is Jesus, our Messiah, raised from the dead through the power of the Father, so that we too may live a new life, a life full of light and truth.
This isn't just an Easter egg. This is the new garden tomb in which our Saviour lay, but which was broken open again on that glorious first Easter Sunday.
This is the tomb with the stone that was rolled away on the third day, giving us a new hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, a new living hope, thanks to the amazing mercy and power of our loving, gracious God and Father.
This isn't just an Easter chick. This is the life that emerges from the broken eggshell. This is the life which is in Christ Jesus, who conquered death and emerged triumphant from the now empty tomb.
This is Jesus showing us that we can be made alive together with him, that anyone in Christ is a new creation, that we have the offer of eternal life, and that we are invited to become members of his royal family. This is Christ telling us that when he returns to earth to claim his rightful throne, we can rule with him in his glory.
This isn't just the Easter bank holiday. This is a celebration of the best news in the world.
This is Jesus saying to us afresh, I am your Messiah and Saviour.
Thank you to all those who did that. Thank you for Nigel for fitting it all together. Thank you. So my question now is the Easter story a fairy tale? Is it a fairy tale? Sounds like it, doesn't it? People say to me, Mark, if I'd been alive that first Easter and I'd seen Jesus with my own eyes come back from the dead, well, then I'd believe it. But I wasn't there, so I don't. Maybe that's how you feel. But I want to ask, if you were alive back then, would you really have believed that Jesus had risen from the dead? Think about it. The 11 disciples, Remember, Jesus had been killed, so there was 11 of them left. They got reports from some women that Jesus is alive and is risen. And do they believe it? And now these two guys come in saying, we've met him. If that was you, how would you feel if you'd been there and you got these reports coming in? Jesus is alive. He's come back from the dead. I bet your first reaction wouldn't be, oh, hallelujah, great news. Your first reaction would be, right, well, that's obviously fake news. You check the calendar. Is it April Fool's? How would you really feel if you'd been there with the disciples and you saw Jesus come back from the dead? Would you have believed it? Really? Or would you think this must be a trick, an hallucination? It must have been a lot simpler for those, country bumpkin types, because that's what we think of the disciples being like. Must be a lot easier for them to have believed Jesus was risen from the dead, because they've never seen cloning, they didn't know about CGI, and know all this stuff. They don't know about plastic surgery, modern medicine. They don't know all the stuff we know, so they see Jesus in front of them, and what do they say? Hallelujah! Welcome back, Jesus! We thought you were gone for good. Let's have a party. Is that what happens? No. Jesus appeared and they were startled and frightened. Pretty odd. Thought this was the first Easter, not Halloween. What's happening? These men are frightened because as simple as they are, they know the facts of death. Once you're dead, you're dead. They've seen it 100 times, they know it. They've seen more deaths than we do. And here's a guy standing in front of them, a guy they've seen stabbed in the side, crucified, beaten. They know he's dead. And here he is, alive. The man who's been rotting in a tomb since Friday, standing there alive and well. Do they just accept that the world they thought they knew has changed and just get on with it? Hallelujah, death is not the end. Of course not. They need a bit more convincing. And so Jesus asked them, why do doubts rise in your mind? And what's he do next? He asked them to check the evidence. Look at my hands. Look at my feet. It is I, myself. Jesus bears the scars where the nails were hammered into his hands, into his wrists, whatever. They're no longer bleeding. He's now healed. These guys recognize Jesus. They've been with him 3 years. This is not an imposter. They know it's the real Jesus, alive and well. But still, probably struggling, thinking, is this hallucination? But really, is that going to work? All of them having the same hallucination all at once? Jesus says, touch me and see, a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have. So you stick your finger where the nails were. You check the hole in his side where the spear went. There's got to be something to explain this, something going on. It's too mind-blowing to think Jesus has actually risen from the dead. There must be another explanation. So Jesus asked them a question. The great theologian Sherlock Holmes said, when you've eliminated all which is impossible, then whatever remains, however improbable, must be the truth. So what about it? Could Jesus standing there be a ghost? That's a bit more believable than a man actually rising from the dead. Jesus says, do you have anything to eat? So they give him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. If Jesus is a ghost, the food presumably will just fall straight through him onto the floor. And yet he eats it, and it goes inside his stomach where they can't see it. It does not fall on the floor. Jesus has an actual flesh and blood body. He is alive. He has risen from the dead. Finally, the disciples get it. This is a wake-up call from God. The world has just changed. It's gone from black and white to technicolor. Jesus is alive. It's not a fairy tale. It's a fact. But so what? What's that mean? What difference does it make knowing Jesus is alive? Well, you've heard some of the difference that Jesus makes. But let me ask you, are you plagued by, I don't know, ill health, pain? Are you worried about death and dying? Are you anxious about the days we're living in? Global warming, the war in Ukraine? The risen Jesus has the answer. Peace be with you, he says. Jesus knew all about pain. He went to the cross. He suffered badly. He stumbled under the weight of the cross. He was so weak because he'd lost so much blood. He was crucified. It was a slow, agonizing death. He knows about pain and suffering. But here he is, that first Easter day, alive and well, appearing to his disciples, saying, come on, check me out. This is fantastic good news for you and me. All believers know that one day we're going to rise again and we're going to be given glorious new bodies. We're not going to be ghosts flying around. We're not going to be angels playing harps on clouds. We're going to have glorious new bodies, bodies which won't get sick, won't age, bodies which won't wear out, get sick, and we shall no longer sin. We'll want to always please God and do what's right. It's also a great comfort knowing that life doesn't go around in meaningless circles. It's got a purpose. It's got a point. When you follow Jesus, life makes sense. One day we're going to get to live with him in his Father's house. There's plenty of room. But it's not all blessings then. Stuff happens now. Life has a purpose. Work suddenly becomes meaningful. Everything we do can have an eternal impact. What Jax was saying about working in the shop. Everything we do has an eternal impact. Life just makes sense. It goes so much better with Jesus in control of it. I want to finish now with a story showing the difference that Jesus can make to a life. In 2015, Indonesia executed 8 foreign-born drug traffickers in Bali. And one of the drug traffickers described his life as a perfect example of a total waste. This is how the men met their end. They were tied with wood cable ties to wooden crosses, their arms outstretched, legs strapped at the bottom. The condemned men sung for one another. They sang a song called 10,000 Reasons and one song, Amazing Grace. And it was an experience the pastor there, Karina De Vega, described as the most beautiful moment she'd ever experienced. They were praising their God. It was breathtaking. This was the first time I witnessed someone so excited to meet their God. And then they were shot. What was going on? How could they be so joyful? During their 10-year wait for execution, these men had been converted. One of them, Andrew Chan, was an Australian, converted, became an ordained minister while behind bars, and he led the English language Christian service in the Kerabokan prison. In his appeal, the governor of the prison described Chan as a model prisoner. He'd helped so many people. He'd made life better in the prison. A positive influence. He asked for mercy for him. There was an interview with Andrew in the Bible Society magazine where he described what happened to him, and I'm going to quote a bit of it. He says, "It wasn't until I was in solitary confinement that I felt the need to be on the right side of God. I found myself in there. At first I thought it was no big deal, I'll get out of this. But it wasn't until I ended up in solitary that I realized I wasn't going to get out of this. In fact, I figured they were going to kill me. I'd never felt so hopeless and alone before. I decided that if they were going to kill me, I just do it myself. So I took my t-shirt, made a noose, and then remembered the heaven and hell issue and decided if I was going to kill myself, I should make sure I ended up in heaven. I wasn't sure how to do that, but I figured I should pray. So I wasn't sure how to do that either. So I looked up and just said, God, if you're real. And in the first time in my life, I began to cry and I ended up on my knees and I cried and I cried. And I said, God, if you're real, send someone who cares about me to see me. And I fell asleep like that. At 6:30 the next morning, a guard woke me up. I swore at him, get up. You've got a visitor. I said, I can't have a visitor. No one knows I'm here. He took me to the visitor area and I saw my brother. And I knew my brother wouldn't just come. We don't like each other. We get along like dogs and cats. So when I got to him, he said, Andrew, no matter what happens or how long it takes, I'm going to be here with you. I told him to bring me a Bible. And I started reading it. I started in Genesis. And I thought, these are a lot of nice stories, but I got nothing out of it. Someone else came to see me, and they were a Christian. Told him I was reading the Bible. Told him I was reading the Bible, that it wasn't getting much out of it. And he said, well, read the New Testament. Read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. So I started to do that. And just before my court date, I read in Mark chapter 11, where it says that if you have enough faith, you can say to this mountain, be removed, and God will do it. So I said, God, if you're real, and if this is true, I want you to free me. And if you do, I'll serve you every day for the rest of my life. I went to my court hearing, and they convicted me, and they gave me the death penalty. When I got back to my cell, I said, God, I ask you to set me free, not kill me. God spoke to me and said, Andrew, I have set you free from the inside out. I have given you life. And from that moment on, I haven't stopped worshiping him. I've never sung before, never led worship until Jesus set me free. Do you see? Andrew described his life as a perfect example of a total waste. And he paid the ultimate penalty for his crimes. But by the grace of God, for a man who didn't deserve it, he met Jesus in prison, the risen Jesus. And Jesus restored his life and used him to release other captives who were in that prison, who'd ended up behind bars, who'd messed up their lives. And they became free in a way that they never knew when they were living so-called free. Friends, God doesn't promise us if we follow him, life's going to get easy. It might get harder. But he does promise that he'll be with us by his Spirit. He'll walk with us and give us strength to cope with what life throws at us. And we can trust God's in control. God doesn't ask us to shut our eyes and make a leap of faith. He encourages us to open our eyes and look at the evidence in his word. And then make a step of faith, like Andrew did. I'm going to just take a moment. I don't know whether God has spoken to you today, whether God has shown you something about him, in his nature, in his character, something you hadn't realized. Maybe there's been a challenge and you feel that God is calling you to do something for him, to take a risk, to take a step of faith. I don't know what God might be saying to you, but please don't shut him out today. Just take a moment and respond in your heart to whatever God is saying to you. Father God, we thank you that you raised Jesus from the dead. We thank you that Jesus is alive and well and is here for us by his Spirit. We thank you that by your Holy Spirit you've been with us today as we've been able to praise you. And I pray for all of us this Easter and beyond, that we will know the joy that comes through following you. And if you're calling us to take bigger risks, give us the courage to trust you to do something big for you. And for those of us who have been called in the everyday to take those big risks, help us, Lord, to stand up for you, to not run away like the disciples, but give us that boldness that comes through knowing that you truly are alive. So we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, thanks for that, Mark. We're going to carry on thinking now about God's resurrection power as we sing In Christ Alone. And why don't you stand for this one?
As we sing this, we're singing to him. We're meeting with him. We're not just singing about him. Let's meet with him as we sing this.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease.
Continue standing as we declare our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Well, do please take a seat, and now here's Roger Gillard to lead us in prayer.
Let us pray. As we think back over the Easter tide that we've just celebrated, let us thank God for all that it has meant to us, that our faith in the love of the Lord Jesus Christ's death and resurrection may be strengthened, and that we may dedicate our lives more wholeheartedly to his service in the days and weeks ahead. Amen. O living Lord, who on that first Easter day did stand in the midst of your disciples as the conqueror of sin and death, and did speak to them your peace, come to us now, we pray, in your risen power, and make us glad with your presence, and so breathe your Holy Spirit into our hearts, that we may be strong to serve you, and by your witness spread abroad your good news, for the glory of your great name. Amen. And let us pray now that the glorious message of Easter may wipe away all doubts that we may be harbouring in our minds. O Lamb of God, Son of the Father, who has taken away the sin of the world and is alive for evermore, grant us the faith that doubts not your word and trusts where it cannot see, that taking hold on your promises, we may rest in your love and rejoice in your mercy, now and always. Amen. Let us pray for the Church, of which we are all members. Let's pray for the Church throughout the world, even in the most distant corners of the earth. The Church in our diocese, and in our parishes of this deanery, and in this benefice. We pray for our bishops John and Martin, for all who preach the good news of the gospel of Christ, and for the members of their congregations, that they may be filled with the love of God and the power to establish your kingdom, O Lord, in the communities and homes in which they live. Amen. We all live in very troubled times at the moment, when the peace of the world is threatened and tragically millions of men, women and children are being forced to become refugees from their homes. And so we pray for the peace in Ukraine. This is a prayer written by the Archbishop of Canterbury and York. God of peace and justice, we pray for the people of Ukraine today. We pray for peace and the laying down of weapons. We pray for all those who fear for tomorrow, that your Holy Spirit of comfort would draw near to them. We pray for those with power over war or peace. We pray for wisdom, discernment, and compassion to guide their decisions. And above all, we pray for all your precious children, at risk and in fear, that you would hold and protect them. And we pray this in the name of Jesus, the Prince of Peace. Amen. And a prayer for the Ukrainian refugees. O Lord, who sees all things, who know the needs of refugees in all lands, we pray at this time particularly for those who have fled Ukraine and now live in homes and churches and camps across Europe. Watch over them. Give wisdom, generosity, and boldness to all who make decisions about their welcome and their welfare, and to all whose hearts move them to offer help. May all Ukrainians' refugees now find true refuge. Amen. We pray for our Queen, and we give you thanks for her long reign and her dedication to the land and the people over whom she reigns. And we pray for all who hold office under her, all ministers of state and all councils at national or local level. We pray that they may be given wisdom when making decisions that affect the well-being of many in this country and abroad. Amen. And we pray also for those seeking to bring aid to parts of the world that are suffering and have suffered from natural disasters recently. And we think particularly at this time of the area of South Africa affected by severe storms and flooding, and those people who've lost their homes and whose homes have been destroyed. We pray that all nations may take seriously the problem of climate change, that they and all people everywhere may respond. Amen. And let us pray for all who are suffering at this time, suffering from sickness of any kind, whether they are in hospitals or nursing or care homes, or whether they are ill at home. And we pray for all who are caring for them, for our doctors and nurses and carers, that they may show the necessary patience and skill to treat or care for them effectively. And we pray particularly today for Tony Parsons, Brenda Parsons, Joan Halling, Dorothy Bowen, Dave Branch, Derek Price, Francis Harcum, Beryl Bateman, Robert England, Simon Barclay, Mary Purser, Julian Hart, Pam Morton, Jean Trevor Morgan, Adrian Francis, and Betty. And our prayers are offered too for the bereaved families and friends of those who have recently lost loved ones, remembering especially Hilda Halling, John Wilson, Geraldine Price, Irene Thackeray, Thelma Wardley, Doris Daffin, and any others who are known to us personally. O Lord our God, into your hands we commend all for whom we have just prayed. Bless them according to their several necessities, out of the abundance of your grace. Amen. And a final prayer for ourselves. Support us, O Lord, all the day long of this troublous life, until the shades lengthen, the evening comes, and the busy world is hushed. The fever of life is over, and our work is done. Then, Lord, in thy mercy, grant us safe lodging, a holy rest, and peace at the last, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Thanks for praying for us, Roger. We're going to continue in prayer now as we pray the church's special prayer for today. And why don't you join with me in this? Almighty Father, you have given your only Son to die for our sins and to rise again for our justification. Grant us so to put away the leaven of malice and wickedness, that we may always serve you in pureness of living and truth, through the merits of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And gathering all our prayers and praises into one, let's pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Well, our final song today is a wonderful Easter song of celebration. Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon the throne. Why don't you stand for this one if you wish? Well, thanks for joining us for worship today. Do please invite others to join us as we gather online and indeed in person week by week. And if this has been your first time with us, I hope you've enjoyed it. We'll be here same time next week. If there's any way we can help you on your spiritual journey in the meantime, do get in touch with me, barry@hopechurchfamily.org. And so, may the risen Christ grant us the joys of eternal life. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Alleluia. Alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Alleluia. Why don't we finish by saying the words of the grace?
May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ
and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen.